Jesus, I sing. Thank you. Romans 8, verse 28 and 29. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters.
Morning, everyone. It's Eric Vandenbroek. Good to for you to see me, I suppose. I can't see you. But anyway, I just wanted to lead us in the elders' prayer. So I'll do that now. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this beautiful week of weather we've had, and that it's been nice and starting to warm up and much more enjoyable to be outside. And we thank you for all the blessings that you give us, God. And even as we're going through these unexpected and somewhat challenging times, we still can see your mercies, and we're blessed by all the things that you give us so freely. And we just thank you that we do have freedoms in this country, and we can still meet even though it's virtually, but we're still able to interact with each other so many other ways, God, and we're so thankful for that, and that it has stretched us and I suppose made us more aware of our surroundings, especially of other people around us. And I pray as we continue to look out for the needs of others, that we would continue to model the life that you lived here, God. And we thank you for all the blessings you've given us, and especially we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus, who died for our sins, which is the reason that we have this opportunity and the reason that we do this. We just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, good day again, folks, and welcome back. And we trust you survived the Mother's Day celebrations and the polar vortex that came our way. And we're going to be talking about smooth sailing ahead, I hope, and good weather and time to get out in the sun. So today I just want to continue thinking about this theme of hope. And the message today is talking about hope in the time of anxiety. And I'm sure that all of us are going through some anxious moments, and anxiety weighs heavy upon us, and maybe even a little depression being stuck inside and so on. And but there's also the bigger issues of life that are going on all around us, and the disease and pandemic that's going on, and family loved ones that maybe have passed away over this period, and very little celebration to go with that. And so I know there's a lot of things in the financial parts of work. So I wanted to continue and use probably a verse that on the one hand is probably one of the best verses that we can hang on to in times of anxiety. But I also think, as we'll talk about a little later, it can be very misapplied and misunderstood. And the verse I'm talking about is Romans 8, 28. But in this pandemic crisis, there are many stories of individuals dealing with the virus to varying degrees and to varying outcomes. And I heard of a woman who is a working professional, and she's a mother of young children, a wife, and she recently contracted COVID-19, which morphed into pneumonia. And not long ago, she was on a ventilator, literally fighting for her life. It was terrifying for her and her family. Thankfully, she's in a relatively better place now and recovering. And on the other hand, there is an older man who has also contracted COVID-19, and things are not looking good for him, and it looks like he's not going to make it. And all of us have stories similar to this during this pandemic time that has affected everyone. And so with that in mind, I just want to have a brief word of prayer as we launch into God's Word. Father, these stories are not uncommon, and Lord, they're two of many stories locally, provincially, nationally, Lord, during this pandemic time. And Father, as I'm able to talk with people, you know as well as anybody the anxiety and the depression and, Lord, all of the things that are accompanying this stay at home and getting through the pandemic. And so, Father, as believers, we want to believe that you are there with us, that all of this is going to be worked through for our betterment and somehow. But Lord, we have to admit at this point right now, we don't see that. And so, Father, help us to understand this very familiar verse, yet often misunderstood verse, Lord, that tells us that you will work all things together for good to those who love you and are called according to your purpose. So, Father, just be with us during this word and apply it to our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, obviously, these are not good things that we're talking about. They are bad things when we talk about the pandemic and some of the effects of the pandemic. And we know that people are losing their jobs and more people will lose their work because of this virus. And when terrible things are happening to us or to people around us, we can start to wonder, is God really good? Can God really be trusted? And Scripture tells us to suspend judgment as to whether something will prove to be good or bad in the end. Because oftentimes we don't know all of the story. The story is told of a wise man who won a Ferrari in a lottery. And his family and friends came to his house and said, "You are lucky." And the man smiled and said, "Maybe." Then one day the man was driving his new sports car, coming through an intersection, and a drunk driver crashed into his new car, causing him all kinds of injuries. And his family and friends showed up at the hospital and they looked at him and said, "You are so unlucky." And the man looked up and said, "Maybe." And then there was a landslide that caused his house to fall into the sea. But he was safe because he was in the hospital. And again, his family and friends came the next day and said, "You are so lucky." And again, the man said, "Maybe." Now, the point of this story is to encourage us to suspend judgment about whether something is going to prove in the end to be good or bad. And we know from experience that some things at first appear to be good, but they turn out to be bad. And other things appear to be bad, but they end up being good. And we know that life is filled with all kinds of unexpected twists and turns. And if we're honest, sometimes life can feel really random. But if our lives are in God's hands, we can know for certain that God will cause all things to work together for our ultimate good. And that familiar verse that I've referred to a few times already is found in Romans 8:28. And the Apostle Paul writes, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose." So let's look at that more closely. And the first point I want to make about this verse is that Paul is referring to our spiritual good, that things work together for our spiritual good. And as we look at the context of this verse, it's important to note that Paul, here in Romans 8, writes about how creation itself is groaning, that the world is suffering. It's going through pains like an expecting mother in labor who wants to deliver her child. And Paul is saying creation groans for new life. I think the same can be said about the world that we see around us these days. As we look further in Romans 8, particularly in verses 35 and 36, we see Paul writes about facing all kinds of suffering, danger, and even possible death. And we know that Paul experienced all these things as well. But it's interesting that Paul never says these things are good in and of themselves. They are bad things, dangers, sufferings, and possible death. But what Paul is saying in Romans 8 and verse 28 is that if we belong to God, God can take all these things, even things that are bad or even evil in and of themselves, and cause them to work for our ultimate good. Now, when Paul says that God causes all things to work together for our good, Paul is referring primarily to our spiritual good, not necessarily our material or financial good. And you might be asking, how do we know that? Well, Paul says in Romans 8 and verse 28, in this very familiar verse, all things work together for good for those who love God. And we all know this verse, and we recite it quite readily, rightly and wrongly in situations. But verse 29 is much less familiar, but it's equally important to verse 28. And what does it say? It says, for those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son. And a clearer translation of this verse says, for those God knew, he chose them to become like his Son. So when the Apostle Paul talks about all things working together for good for those who love God, the good that he means is our being made like Jesus. And this truth makes Romans 8:28 such a great verse, but at the same time, the most misunderstood and most applied verse in all of Scripture. And that's what I want to look at this point, how it became the most misunderstood and misapplied verse. Well, let's say someone loses their job because of COVID-19. That's devastating on lots of different levels. It would be glib and wrong to say to that person, based on Romans 8:28, that all things are working together for good, so that means you're going to get a better and higher paying job. Because that probably is not going to be true. But what I want us to realize is that there are some gifts during whatever painful seasons we may be called on to endure. We can learn to depend on God more fully. We can look at these times and see how God provides for us. We can rest in his love and his grace and his peace without all the worry, knowing that God is at work. And we can become more grateful to God for all those things to this very day. They become like memorials in our faith journey to look back on and see how God was faithful to us in working all these things for our good. And sort of the mathematical statement at this point is that God has done it before, it equals that he will do that again. If he was with us before in our trials, he'll be with us in this one. If he will provide, then he will provide. Paul is saying in Romans 8 and verse 28 that God can choreograph all things, even bad and painful things, and even evil things, for our ultimate good, so that we are made more like his Son, Jesus. At this point, I just want us to pause and think about probably one of the best examples in Scripture about this principle that I'm talking about, and that's the story of Joseph. And the Joseph I'm referring to is the Joseph in the Old Testament, one of the sons of Jacob. And Joseph is one of 12 brothers and his father's favorite, which creates a lot of jealousy, and they hate him within this band of brothers. And one day they attack him and throw him into a pit and eventually sell him into slavery. And Joseph loses everything dear to him, his father, his family, his food, his financial security, and his freedom. And he cries out for mercy to his brothers, but also to God. But heaven seems silent. Joseph is a handsome guy, and because of this, he draws the advances of his boss's wife. And when he refuses her advances, she levels false accusations of Joseph, and he's thrown in prison. And he spends 10 years in prison while he's there. He cultivates a spiritual gift for being able to interpret dreams. And one day, Pharaoh, the ruler of all Egypt, has a very vivid and disturbing dream, and he learns about Joseph's gift from the gods, to be able to understand and interpret dreams, as he would put it. And Pharaoh summons Joseph, and with God's help, is able to interpret it. And the dream foretells of a great famine that will come to Egypt, and that while the harvests are plentiful, they need to start storing away grain to help survive the years of drought. Pharaoh recognizes the wisdom of Joseph and on the spot promotes him from a prisoner to a prime minister over all Egypt. And in about 7 years, famine hits and the region starts to suffer from hunger and starvation. And this includes Joseph's family back in Canaan. And they run out of food, make their way to Egypt, and find themselves standing before their very brother. But they don't recognize him. And because of the way they are being treated, they begin to lament that God is punishing them for what they did to their brother Joseph. Well, at some point, Joseph can't stand it any longer, and after dismissing his staff, reveals that he is their brother Joseph, who they sold into slavery years ago. And the brothers are convinced that he is going to extract revenge on them, but Joseph doesn't do that. He says in Genesis 50 and verse 20, a huge verse for all of us, and he says, "What you meant for evil, God meant it for good, to bring about the saving of many lives." And the word "meant" literally means to weave. And Joseph understood back then that God could take evil and bad things and weave them together for our ultimate good, so we become more like Jesus. That's what Paul is trying to get at in this verse. And so the next point that comes from this verse is the point of being God's good gift. And COVID-19 is a bad thing, but there are good gifts that God can bring even from this pandemic. Firstly, through this COVID-19 pandemic, I have been reminded, as probably many of you have, that I do not control my life. At times, we convince ourselves that we can influence the outcome of some things in our life. At times, we even live day to day believing we are in control of our lives. But I believe COVID-19 has shown us just how utterly dependent upon God we are. And the thought that I am in control of things is merely a pleasant human illusion. Jesus Christ, God's Son, knew that he was utterly, completely, and totally dependent on God his Father. And so to the extent that you and I realize our dependence on God in these days, we are being conformed a little bit more each day into the image of his Son, Jesus. Stories abound of many Christians who, when they displayed the symptoms of COVID-19, went into either self-isolation or legally required isolation. And many have shared that when they were in isolation, they began to realize how much their identity was bound up in their work, in their identity and position, in their many aspects of their lives. But many of those same people, while in isolation, came to realize more fully that the core of their identity is not in doing things or being productive or being needed, but it's in simply being a beloved child of God and trusting him. COVID-19 is bad. It is destructive. But I believe God is going to bring about some good gifts through this pandemic. And during this time of difficulty, during this season with God's help, you and I can grow deeper and wiser and more compassionate and more courageous. We must learn and remember that the most important part of our storyline is not what we do, not what we produce, not what we have, but that the central drama of our life is who we are becoming. And insofar as our Creator is concerned, God the Father is more concerned with who we are becoming, and that will always be center stage. So this moment in history, this final point that I want to make as we wrap this up, this world pandemic event may be the moments of greatest opportunity in our life to grow more like Jesus. We can embrace the truth of Romans 8:28 that God is good. And if our lives are in His hands, He is working all things for our ultimate good, even when life circumstances suggest that is not true. Even when we may feel like Joseph, perhaps we're in a dark pit or we're in a prison of despair like Joseph, we can by faith affirm that God is good, and we can say, God, I will trust you even through this. Many of us right now are spending more time at home than ever before. Could this be a unique window of time to make our homes, our apartments, into a kind of sanctuary where we meet God? Or maybe a better analogy would be to envision its image as a furnace, especially if you need to work from home. You've got a bunch of restless kids, probably. Things are ramping up for you, and so maybe a furnace is a better image. But could this time right now in our homes be the space where our eyes are open to God in new ways, where our eyes are open to what is more important than what is most essential, where we discover our shadow side, our darkness, but where we invite the light of God, the love of God, to bring us healing and make us whole? If we believe that God took the most tragic, ugly, and worst moment in human history, and I'm speaking of the death, burial, and resurrection of His Son Jesus, and transformed that moment into the most beautiful gift the world has ever known for our good, don't you think He can and will do this with this COVID-19 pandemic? And if you believe that God is willing and able to do that creatively and powerfully in our individual lives, then at this point I invite you to give Him that disease you're facing down, or the loss of your job, or the loss of a relationship, or whatever you may be facing. Give it to Him. That God could take sin, our own sin, or a sin against us. That God could even take death, someone else's death, or our own death, and transform it into something truly beautiful. That is good. So, in summary today, put your life in God's hands. And I repeat that, put your life in God's hands, and all things, will start to work for your ultimate good as God weaves your life into something truly glorious and beautiful. As God makes us more and more like His Son, Jesus Christ. And remember the promise that Paul made to the church in Philippi. And remember that He who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for these words. We thank you for the truth of Scripture. We thank you that you inspired writers like Paul to give us glimpses of the truth that you want us to know and we can grow by. And Father, as we give our lives to you, as we build that relationship with you, we can be trusting in you to bring all things to the completion you want them to. But Lord, we can also take that a step further and know that we can have that peace and we can put the anxiety on the shelf because we know that you are going to work out things for the ultimate good. And that through all of these scenarios, all of these situations, the good will help us grow more like Jesus Christ. And that's always a good thing. And so, Father, I pray that we would take this verse in a new light and see it through the eyes of this situation, this pandemic that we see ourselves in, that you are doing the work and that you will continue that work and that good will come from it. And we give you praise and thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
There's a